Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Welcome to a live session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal, and this is a live program that is being broadcast on multiple platforms that includes Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. On any of these platforms, if you are joining me, you can submit your questions about Islam, about Ahmadiyyat, about other world religions. Answers are provided in light of resources found on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, www.alislam.org. That is alislam.org. That is the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. As I mentioned, I am a missionary of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community and here to respond to your questions. If you are on YouTube, you can use a live chat to submit your questions. If you are on Facebook, you can use the comments section to submit your questions and join this discussion. Today, I have picked up a topic, the topic of the knowledge of the unseen. So one of the proofs of the truthfulness of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, is that he was granted knowledge of the unseen. So some time back, one of my articles was published on Al-Islam, and it discusses this topic, and I wanted to just take a moment to show you. So if you want to find this article, type in establishing the truthfulness of the promised Messiah, and it will in the search results show you this article establishing the truthfulness of the promised Messiah alayhi salam from the Holy Quran. Verse number 6 is what I wanted to talk about a little bit today, which says alimul ghaibi fala yuzhiru ala ghaibihi ahadan illa man irtada min rasul. This is chapter 72 verses 27 to 28. So in these verses, Allah says he is the knower of the unseen and he reveals not his secrets to anyone except to a messenger of his whom he chooses. So in other words, knowledge of the unseen is granted to those who are the servants, the messengers of God Almighty. And if it is proven that this knowledge of the unseen is demonstrated through the promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, that would make him the true Messiah. So recently, I had a conversation with a non-Ahmadi friend, and he asked me, what is the evidence that the promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, actually was granted this knowledge of the unseen? And I took the opportunity to share with him one of the writings of Hazrat Musaylimah Maud, radiyallahu anhu, Invitation to Ahmadiyyat. Invitation to Ahmadiyyat is a book where Hazrat Musaylimah Maud, radiyallahu anhu, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad, radiyallahu anhu, has explained this and has given the proofs of this knowledge of the unseen that was granted in the form of prophecies. Right, there are other kinds of knowledge that was granted to the promised Messiah that has its own significance, but the prophecies that were granted to him specifically show this extraordinary knowledge of the unseen that was granted to the promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salam. So if you I believe it is, yes, it's the same verse that is discussed in the beginning of this section on prophecies. And there are many, many prophecies that are out there, but some of those prophecies are discussed in this section of Invitation to Ahmadiyyat. Afghan martyrs, the revolution in Iran, the prophecy about Abdullah Atam, all these other prophecies that are out there for us to study and to come to an understanding of how they were fulfilled, and everything was stated beforehand, and later on it came out to be true. So this is an interesting page which lists these prophecies, and you can go through these and at least get a simple explanation, the chronological events that occurred where the prophecy is made beforehand, and later on we see its fulfillment. One of the prophecies is the death of Lake Ram, which proved to be a great sign, and this is something that has been discussed thoroughly in the writings of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. And its fulfillment, as Hazur has noted here, moved several hundred thousand persons and convinced them of the truth of Islam and persuaded many of them to declare openly that Islam was the true religion. The effect of this prophecy has continued ever since. And the circumstances, I don't want to read through all of this, but basically this person, Lake Ram, was a very bitter opponent of Islam, and he used to write very negative material about the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And eventually, the promised Messiah alaihi salam received a revelation about him that within 6 years, counting from February 20th, 1893, this person would die. And these are the words of the prophecy, the revelation, and and there were some further details that were given about it, and all these are given here. And the prophecy was fulfilled exactly according to how it was foretold. So put together, the prophecies relating to Lake Ram foretold that Lake Ram would meet with a calamity which would prove fatal for him. This calamity would take place within 6 years. It would be on a day close to Eid, just before or just after, that he would meet with the fate of the calf of Samri, that is dismemberment and death and dispersion of his ashes into a river. This fatal process would be carried out by a ruddy person with bloodshot eyes, and that he would be a victim of the sword of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So all these details are in the prophecy, and they were fulfilled. This prophecy was fulfilled exactly according to how it was foretold. So I just wanted to take a few minutes in the beginning of this session today to talk about this phenomena of prophecies being fulfilled. And that itself shows that knowledge of the unseen was granted to the promised Messiah alayhi salam, which in turn proves his truthfulness. If knowledge of the unseen is granted to a chosen servant of God Almighty, that is ample proof of his truthfulness. If the Holy Quran is full of knowledge of the unseen, it proves, for instance, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam could not have come up with this knowledge on his own. If the Quran has so many details about things that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam could never have stated by his own self, that would prove that the Quran is from God Almighty. And if the Quran is from God Almighty, if the Quran is a book that is not a product of human design, that means there is a designer, that there is a creator who is the one from whom the Holy Quran came. So it proves the truthfulness of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It proves the truthfulness of the Holy Quran. It proves the existence of God, etc., etc. All these proofs are contained through the Holy Quran. And because the Holy Quran tells us that only messengers of God are granted knowledge of the unseen, that means that the promised Messiah alayhi salam is also true. Many have joined this session. I appreciate all of you who joined on this session. One person has asked about cousin marriages. What are your thoughts on cousin marriage? Cousin marriages are allowed in Islam. This is in the Holy Quran. It's very clear where the relations or the prohibited degrees are mentioned. Cousins are not within those degrees, which means that cousins can get married. Now, this question has been posed to Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad Rahimahullah Ta'ala also. On several occasions, he was asked this question, and he has given his thoughts on it as well. So instead of repeating what he has stated, might as well show you how to reach the link where you can find what he has said. What you need to do is, on the main page of alislam.org, click on Ask Islam. When you click on Ask Islam, type in cousin, And there are a couple of questions that have the audio and video answer of Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad Rahimahullah Ta'ala on this topic. Okay, so there are some people who say that cousin marriages can lead to some kind of disease or anything like that. The scientific studies, personally, I have not looked at them yet, but I'm not convinced by them yet. If there is a generational repeat of cousin marriages, that is a question mark. I haven't looked at the scientific evidence on that yet. But having said, the fact is that cousin marriages are allowed in Islam, but that doesn't mean that Islam says that every time a marriage has to be arranged, it should be or must be a cousin marriage, right? Cousin marriage is one of the possibilities, but it is not something that is, absolute. Or if somebody is not comfortable, that is up to them. It is not something that can be forced on anyone. No one can be obliged to go ahead with this kind of marriage. Okay. One person has asked about Hazrat Fatima Raziallahu Anha not getting a piece of land that she believed was gifted to her by her father, the Holy Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is an age-old question that has been part of Sunni and Shia debates for millennia. It's more than 1,000 years long debate. So I'm not sure if I can add anything to this debate. There are lots of books that have been written on this, point of contention that has been there. And a lot of times I feel that it can get emotional and their emotions get involved. Hazrat Fatima radiallahu anha obviously has a very high status. She was told by the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that she would be the head of the women in paradise. She was obviously the daughter of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who had sons, and the only one who had children that grew up to adulthood. And so we have great respect for her. We have great love for her. We honor her greatly. Regarding this difference of opinion that she had with Hazrat Abubakar radiallahu anhu, we leave the matter to Allah. We are 1500 or almost 1500 years removed from that time when this occurred. We were not there ourselves. We don't have all the historical data that tells us exactly what happened. We have some narrations, and some of those narrations might even be contradictory. So Allah knows best. When it comes to the Sahaba, when it comes to the companions of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we leave their matter to Allah. We know that there are some other occasions where the disagreements were so great that even there were some wars that occurred. But even despite those wars, the Ahmadiyya Muslim perspective is very clear on this, that we leave these matters to Allah. We are not going to start judging the Sahaba and say that one Sahabi was on the right and the other Sahabi was on the wrong. Intellectually, academically, in some cases, we might be able to say. For instance, we have the example of Hazrat Saad bin Ubadah radiallahu anhu, who never accepted the bath of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu or Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu. And I was reading some material on that recently. So that doesn't mean that we have any hatred for him or anything like that. We do understand that he was not on the right path. Similarly, on the right side in this debate, right path would not be the right word, because that is for Allah to decide who is on the right path and who is on the wrong path. We would say that as far as the decision to not pledge allegiance to the Khalifa of the time would not be the correct way to proceed. Similarly, we know that when Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu was the Khalifa, Hazrat Amir Muawiyah, who is also, by the way, a companion of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not accept his Khilafat. And in that case also, we feel that Hazrat Amir Muawiyah was not correct in his opinion. So that doesn't mean that we have to now start finding material against those people and start to make them look bad or anything like that. We leave those matters to Allah. We are not the judges of the Sahaba. We are not the judges of the companions of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Their matter rests with Allah. In this case also, the Khalifa of the time, that is Hazrat Abubakar radiallahu anhu, made a decision. And the Khalifa is the successor, and he is the one who can make those decisions. So it is up to Allah. Hazrat Abubakar radiallahu anhu also had a great status. He is mentioned even in the Holy Quran. So, not by name, but indirectly. So he has a status as well, and we don't want to start comparing and taking sides. Okay. One person has asked that, did the promised Messiah alayhi salam ever use foul language, as his opponents say? You know, this issue about the foul language is much, you can say, it is portrayed in a way which is very negative and very wrong. And it moves away from the reality. If you are talking about strong language, we have strong language in the Holy Quran. There are words in the Holy Quran that are very strong. And if we are talking about strong language, it is found in the Ahadith. If we are talking about strong language, it is found in the Bible. It is found in the Old Testament or the Hebrew Bible and the New Testament. And if we are talking about a similar kind of strong language, it is found in the writings of the promised Messiah alayhi salam as well. And he talked about this in his lifetime. He said that strong language that I have used in my writings, it is not meant to be foul, quote unquote, in any way. It is a strong language that is used for multiple purposes. Number one, it was an expression of truth. There's a difference between, you know, when somebody uses foul language, they are actually trying to insult the other person and not use the true, not based on truth, right? There's no truth to foul language. It's totally made up. When it's only meant to hurt and cause offense and to say something that is not the reality. But when prophets of God or when God himself uses strong language, he is basically expressing a truth about their inner spiritual condition. Okay? So there's a difference. It's like a comparison of apples and oranges. And because a lot of these opponents, or in fact, all of these opponents, do not accept the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, they see him as just any other ordinary human being, and they will see that this language is not right. But their perspective, they are coming with a bias when it comes to this situation. But if you remove that bias, and even for a moment you remove the bias of being an Ahmadi, like if you're talking to an Ahmadi Muslim who believes in the Messiah, even if you remove that bias, just look at the way the books of God and the prophets of God have spoken. And if the promised Messiah alayhi salam is different from that, then there could be a case, but it is not. So that's one reason. Another reason, and this I remember reading in Kitab al-Bariyah, it's in Urdu, I'm not sure if you can read Urdu, but in Kitab al-Bariyah, the promised Messiah alayhi salam has talked about this to a certain extent. He has actually quoted several pages from the writings of the Christians who used such enormously bad language against the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the promised Messiah alayhi salam says that I have done this to show you the negativity that exists in those, the criticisms, which are not just criticisms, but just simply the language is so awful in those books, that in response to that, using a little bit of strong language is just meant to make the other side realize what they're doing and to tone it down when it comes to their behavior. So that's another angle. Question. And I don't know whether there are any articles in English that deal with this issue that are found on Al-Islam, but we can definitely, if you go to alislam.org and maybe we type this and see if there is any refutation of insult. Okay, so there is the refutation of the allegation of insult to Jesus Christ. So there's definitely that resource that you can study in order to read this. The opponents of the promised Messiah, this objection that he called them this term, and then the response to that, and some of his quotations are given here. So there's that wonderful article, or rather part of a book, Truth About Ahmadiyyat. This is also discussed there. So these are resources that are available on Al-Islam that you can use to learn more on this topic. One person has asked that in what languages did Mirza Sahib receive revelation and in what forms? First of all, I believe that you are writing as a non-Ahmadi Muslim. So it is a humble request that when you write his name, kindly put his full name or at least a part of his full name. So you can write Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Sahib. That is his full name. Or Ghulam Ahmad, also you can use that name as well. You're asking that in what languages did he receive his revelation and in what forms? I'm not sure what you mean by forms. His receipt of revelation was similar to other prophets, where Angel Gabriel came to him and spoke to him and delivered the message of God. And in some occasions, God spoke to him directly. So this is even in the Holy Quran, it is mentioned that sometimes God speaks directly, sometimes he sends an angel, and sometimes he sends visions and dreams. So in all three these forms, this revelation is Messiah alayhi salam. In what languages? You can go to alislam.org and go to alislam.org and type in Tazkara, which is a book which compiles those revelations. So they are in the English language as well, but primarily in Arabic and Urdu. So Arabic and Urdu are the main languages. And then there is English, there's even a few in Punjabi, and there's Persian. So these are the languages that in which the revelations came. You can consult this book if you like to go through them. And in fact, there's an index near the end. It's a big book. So there's an index in the end, right? Punjabi and other languages. There's Urdu. So you can go through this and hopefully this would answer your question. Urdu revelations, Arabic, you can see it already here. So it's a big book. It takes too long to scroll through it, but I hope that you are able to get your answer to this question. One person has asked about a dream. I I cannot interpret your dream, in a live stream like this. If you want to find the interpretation, there are books available online, which you can find on the interpretation of dreams, and that could answer your question in a better way. Trying to find some questions, lots of comments as well. One person has asked about the donkey of the Dajjal. So the donkey of the Dajjal, if we look at the Ahadith, there are some details given about it. And there is, first of all, we have to understand who is Dajjal. So regarding Dajjal, I would like to make a comment that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is clearly reported to have said that if you want to safeguard yourselves from the Dajjal, you should read the first and last 10 verses of Surah Al-Kahf. When we go to the first and last 10 verses of Surah Al-Kahf, we find mention of only two evils. One evil is the Christian doctrine of attributing partners to God in the form of the Son of God. And the other evil that is mentioned is that of materialism, which is in the last 10 verses. So we find the doctrine of associating partners with God in the form of Christianity and materialism discussed in those verses. There is no mention of a one-eyed big man or something like that who is the Dajjal. So what does that mean? That means that those verses are our security against the Dajjal because they refute the ideologies of shirk and the pursuit of materialism. When we look at the Ahadith also, we find that the Dajjal was not someone that was pinpointed directly. In fact, there was even mention of a person who was not one-eyed. His name was Ibn Sayyad. If you read the Ahadith, especially in Mishkat, if you open the section on the Dajjal, you will come across the mention of a person named Ibn Sayyad, who's a human being. And he was presumed to be the Dajjal. And the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself never denied this possibility. He acknowledged the possibility. And that means, and there was no question that where is the donkey and where is all those things. So we have to understand that there is a lot of metaphor when it comes to these kinds of prophecies. If you want to know more about the Dajjal, same thing you can do is you go to alislam.org, and on alislam, simply in the search bar, type Dajjal and you will get some resources. Dajjal or the Antichrist, for instance, there's a page where there's this video that is about Dajjal. Then there's a Friday sermon from 1982, non-Ahmadi Muslims concept of the Dajjal. So there's discussion here. I believe, in fact, if you go to Al Islam main page and then click on Ask Islam, in here also you will find some question and answer that might be related to this. So yes, there is Dajjal. Spelling is different, right? So, and it is talking about Surah Al-Kahf that is to be recited in relation to the Dajjal. So there are these resources that you can use to improve your understanding of the Dajjal. Question, another question is that, do you think that there was a possibility that Musaylimah was a Muslim because the Sunni history isn't reliable? Musaylimah was clearly someone who used to be a Muslim, but later on, through his claims, he started a different community. I don't know what he called that community, but he definitely rebelled against Islamic norms or values very clearly. And he tried to start a new religion. So there's no doubt about that. And yes, the history might not be reliable, but it could not have totally missed the identity of that person or some of his basic ideas. So he cannot be considered a Muslim, quote unquote, in that truest sense. Did Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salam come to unite us all? That is part of the aims of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, is to bring the entire world under the banner of Islam, but not through any kind of wars or oppression or persecution or anything like that, but with a message of love. We want to bring people together by their own will. People, when they are shown the true image of Islam and the true beauties of Islam, they will flock to the religion of Islam by themselves. We would not have to, talk to people, because once they know about the beauties of Islam, they would be attracted to it. So talking to people about the beauties of Islam is a part of our effort so that they come to know about these things. If your question is that why has that not happened yet, the answer is that there's a process. With every prophet of Allah, there's a process. If the question was, did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam come to unite us all, my answer would again be yes. He has come as the final messenger for the whole of mankind, so that the whole of mankind can worship one God. But it's a process. It takes time. But now, with the coming of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, we see that time is not too far off into the future. It is not too distant from us. And inshallah, as the decades go by, as the century passes, we will start to see this happen. We're already, in a way, starting to see, because more than 210 countries in the world, Ahmadiyya Muslim Mission or Ahmadiyya Muslim Community has been established. And many more many more missions and many more places are being established. Okay, so with due time, this will happen. And one way that this will happen is through the system of Khilafat. We have Khilafat after the successorship, after the promised Messiah, and through that Khilafat, inshallah, this will happen. One person has asked that, what do you say to those who say Hazrat Abubakar radiallahu anhu stole the Khilafat of Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu? I would say that there is no evidence for that. I would say that there is no clear evidence of that, because Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu was not afraid to speak his mind. If he had disagreed with something, he would have openly said it. And he would have expressed his opinion. But throughout the Khilafat of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and the Khilafat of Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu and Hazrat Usman radiallahu anhu, he never rebelled and never said that this is not right and this has been stolen from me. Last question that I'm going to take for today is that, or second last question, there's one more question I would like to take after this, that in the summer, Isha time gets late, so it gets a little delayed to go to sleep. So is it okay if we combine Maghrib and Isha prayers in the summer? The only permission that for this has been granted to mosques and namaz centers, and that too for only 2 months. In the peak of summer, for 2 months, Maghrib and Isha prayers are combined. because people have to come to the mosque, and it might take, if somebody's living, let's say, 10 minutes away from the mosque, they have to get ready, and then they have to drive 10 minutes to the mosque, they have to offer the prayer, and then come back. The whole process can take, you know, including the prayers and the dars maybe after the prayers, the whole process can take a good 40 to 45 minutes. And so for the convenience of those people, the permission is that they can combine the prayers for 2 months. However, if we are offering prayer at home, then we are not going anywhere. It is not taking a long time. So we should offer the two prayers separately on their at their time. I'm not sure which country you are from, but in most of Canada, this is the norm. It is possible that if you offer, as of today, for instance, the Maghrib time, or rather the sunset time, where I am is 8:50 p.m. So the maximum for Isha prayer is that you have to offer it after 10 p.m. And I know it can get a little bit of challenging, but we have to offer the prayer separately, unless there is something that is urgently that you have to do early in the morning. On those rare occasions, that could be a possibility, but not on a daily basis throughout summer. That should not be the norm. Okay. Does it say in the Quran that women have to obey their husbands? Obedience to the husband, in to a certain extent, it is discussed in the ahadith. Right? In the ahadith, it is mentioned. I'm trying to think of a verse of the Holy Quran that specifically says that the wife should be obedient to her husband. I can't think of it. But in the ahadith, we do have mentioned that the husband is like the head of the household. And at some point, there are some decisions where you need one final person to take a final decision. Right? And in those cases, if the decision is not something that is harsh, or that is not harsh, but it is against the principles of Islam, it should be followed by the family. Otherwise, how can the family unit run without a final decision? Having said that, the husband and wife should make that decision mutually. The Quran is clear in saying that وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, that to the wives, the husbands should be very caring and loving and compassionate and kind. In fact, if you look at the responsibilities, just yesterday I was watching this video of Hazur, where he said that if you look at the promised Messiah has talked about this, that if a husband were to know the kind of responsibilities he has towards his wife and children, he wouldn't even want to get married. So the responsibilities are so great in marriage, and they should not, and it should not be that the husband is taking that chance to impose a kind of dictatorship or anything like that. It should be a mutual decision. And of course, there are some areas and some things in which the wife has to make the final decision, like in relation to the proper upbringing and moral training. The wife has the upper hand because she knows, the mother would know the needs of the children in a much more nuanced and better way than the father. So it is something that, I know I'm not giving you a very perfectly straight answer, but I'm thinking as I'm speaking. So what I'm trying to say is that there is a balance, that an equilibrium, that in some cases the wife does have the upper hand in her decision, or she has autonomy. And in other cases, as I said, the husband is the head of the family, and he should be respected, and he should be there are certain decisions that he has to take about certain realities that the family has to face. So the hadith mentioned this. If you want to know more on this topic, you can go to alislam.org. And in the search bar, there are a couple of books, Domestic Issues and Their Solutions, that are compilations of addresses of Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, may Allah be his helper. There is this one, Domestic Issues and Their Solutions, and Paradise Under Your Feet. I'm not sure about this one, but Garments for Each Other, for sure. This book is also a compilation of those addresses. So go through these books, and they will provide you guidance on this topic. That's all the time I had for today. I really appreciate all of you who joined me for today. Jazakumullah. And assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Ali Muhammadin. Kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala Ali Ibrahim. Innaka hamidu majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammadin wa ala Ali Muhammadin. Kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala Ali Ibrahim. Innaka hamidu majid.